Welcome, Professor G.S. Vajpayee. It's a pleasure to welcome you for the session Crime Free Bharat. Today we will be discussing Crime Free Bharat and requirement or legal enabling or statutory enabling required to make our country crime free. So before talking about Crime Free Bharat, I would like to really introduce Honorable Professor and Registrar, National Law University, Delhi, Professor Dr. G.S. Vajpayee. He is heading, or rather he is a member secretary on a very important committee. That committee has been entrusted with the responsibility of recommending law-related reforms. He is a chairperson of Center for Criminology and Victimology in National Law University. He is a chair professor for K.L. Arora Chair on Criminal Law. He is also chair for Theodore Eisenberg Center for Empirical Legal Research. He is president for Indian Society of Victimology. He is a vice chairman for Indian Society of Criminology. He is vice president of Victim Support Asia, South Korea. He is editor of Journal of Victimology and Victim Justice. He is also editor of Indian Journal of Criminology and life member of Asian Society of Criminology. He is also executive member of World Society for Victimology. He is a member of International Society for Criminology and member of the International Society for Reforms of Criminal Law and life member of various institutes. As you could read from introduction, Dr. Vajpayee, Professor Vajpayee, is a very renowned person, as well as he is a best suited for today's deliberation, because we cannot think of crime-free Bharat unless we provide a legal architecture, a statutory basis. And largely so, because as you understand that policing is a state subject. So in entry 2, list 2, schedule 7 of constitution, policing, including rural and railway policing, that is the responsibility of state government. And generally center will say that nothing could be done by them, because policing is largely a state subject. And that's why we have to really come out with a legislative support. And while looking for the legislative support, I was looking for a all India support, because we are talking of the crime-free Bharat. We are not talking of crime-free of particular district. So that framework has to be a national framework. That's why we had to look into entry 1 of Schedule 7 of our constitution, which is the central list. Luckily for me, I could locate one entry, that is 65C, which very clearly says that creating formations and institutions for scientific and technical assistance in investigation and detection of crime, that is the responsibility of central government. And this crime-free Bharat concept is nothing but a scientific and technical assistance in investigation and detection of crime, without really changing or disturbing the finer federal balance of the policing in favor of center. So it is not like NIA, it is not like a CBI, where some power is being enjoyed by central agencies. Crime-free Bharat, it provides 5 certainties. Certainty of registration, even without visiting police station. Because we understand that despite there are various promulgation, various pronouncement by the apex court in Lalita Kumari versus state of UP, and even there are many others, right? From 1971, there had been a consistent efforts on the part of the Apex Court to help out citizen that their report should be properly converted into FIR. But as we know that our practical experience is day by day worsening, and getting FIR registered is getting very difficult. And this is the common experience of each of one of us. Hence, we have to come out with the five certainty. And the first certainty is certainty of cognizance of FIR or report, even without visiting police station. And there's a little stress, even without visiting police station, because we are of the firm view that in very many cases, visiting police station is not going to help out. While we want to grant this kind of the power to the citizen, we were equally sensitive about the misuse of this power. Because we know in RTI, lot of hanky-panky things, the lot many blackmailer or in the car of an NGO or anything, they are basically seeking information and then using that information for blackmailing and demoralizing public servant. So this particular certainty is having a twin responsibility. It says it will also certainly prosecute such complainant who will be lodging false FIR. And there's already legal provision for prosecution. So that is 182 and 211 of IPC. But we have recommended that these two sections, they should be made cognizable, non-valuable, or we can say availability and non-valuability may go along with the what kind of the false report is being made. So the punishment may come from there. Then it is guaranteeing right to privacy, because this privacy is a very delicate issue. And since we are creating such a powerful engine, powerful system, so the critic would like to take or would like to criticize and would like to oppose it, taking garb of the privacy. So we say, hey, we will not allow you to do that. We ourselves guaranteeing the right to the privacy. So it is guaranteeing right to privacy, number one. It is helping out the police. And it is saying, I will unburden you and I will de-stress you. So a lot of non-core responsibility of the police would be moving to the public side by making use of the technology. And the police will be de-burdened and would be supported by that. A lot of things will be done by the public for the sake of police. What for the privacy, the raw data will not be coming to the police. So we have made an engine. We have made a back-end office, or you can say a powerful support system, which will be in position to give them investigation lead in a very, very layman language with the compliance module attached. And it will be generating the performance index also. Later on, that performance index may be converted or may be used for promotion, transfer, posting, and all kind of things. And once we could do that, then we would be in position to channelize the energy of the police force in the right direction. It is taking out a lot of things from historical data. It is having its own engines and different modules. So that raw data, which is not very meaningful at the moment, that is being converted into a very powerful Johanna input to the investigating officer on the real-time basis. Then it is helping out the police in requisitioning information about the evidence wherever it might be sitting under Section 91 of CRPC. But at the same time, not many people, they don't really give information because they feel themselves too big, because they all the time feel that the person who is requisitioning, he is of the rank of service inspector or inspector, and they are a big officer. So sometimes they really try to browbeat, or they don't comply with the legal mandated. So this engine would be helping out police in getting such people prosecuted under Section 91, read with 188 of IPC. It is having a distributed intelligence. So from CCTV and IoT devices, lot of real-time evidence would be captured and would be made available to the police officer. We are also of the very, very considered view. We are not going to court with the by proclaiming or saying technological superiority. Because the moment we will go to the court with the technological superiority, our jo hai na, so-called intellectual vidwan, jo hai na, jo defense lawyers, hai, they will try to demolish under on one plea or other plea, or they will say the false positive or negative. So we are saying no false positive, no false negative. The process data, instead of being pushed to the court directly, it will be pushed to the expert. And the government has evidence that has been amended, and it is already recognizing various kind of experts. So section 41, 45 A, B, C, D, E, etc. So making use of this recent amendment, we would be pushing this data to various experts. We will be creating n number of experts, n number of the people will be notified as expert, and we will be providing them the real time tool and framework, so that they can provide their report almost on the real time basis, and their report will be so picturally powerfully will be presented, court as well as any other layman would be in position to appreciate their opinion. So here we are also creating additional evidence in the form of expert opinion. So now the dependency will not only remain on 27's Evidence Act, but lot many evidence will come from section 8 and section 9, that conduct prior and after, because the technology would be in position to draw whole chain prior to the crime and after the crime. Those evidences will be captured. It will be something like a cricket match. Earlier in cricket match, umpire decision used to have to be deciding factors, but now no umpire will dare to pronounce any wrong judgment, and they will try to look into technology and third eye or third umpire, and then they will make a right decision only. In time to come, our magistracy will be making or they will be so much enabled that likelihood of miscarriage of justice on any ground will not be there, or that will be highly minimized. The third probability is the probability of or certainty of conviction. So we have video based trial system, a lot many things has been done for the court. So not only that, we would be in position to procure conviction in majority of the cases with the powerful evidences sitting behind it, but we would be in position to conduct those trial at very fast pace. And we are having a strategy to dissolve the pendency of 3 crore, and the moment this pendency of 3 crore has been resolved and we are in position to pronounce judgment within a month or 3 months, I think it will be taking out lot of distortion which is sitting in the system at the moment. Then it is having the fourth certainty, that certainty of prevention. So lot of data input, which we have already guaranteed the right to privacy, so that data input analytics will be put to use, and we are in position to identify to a great degree of certainty that these buggers, they are going to commit crime. That will be inferred on the basis of various attributes, and there could be a smart intervention strategy that we can catch criminal even before they could actually commit crime. So they will be booked for preparing for committing crime wherever that is crime, or attempting to commit crime wherever that is the crime, or if nothing else is there, then they will be booked because there is a substantive proof, we can book them for under the preventive section. So in future, committing crime will not be an option. So there is a certainty of prevention. Now question comes that when we know so much about everything and about everybody, when they have purchased a book or when they have purchased a shirt or acquired a vehicle, with whom they are moving and how they are moving, whether they are having weapon or not, those kind of the inferences are already sitting in database, then it will be a foolishness that wait and allow them to commit crime. So it is prompting the fifth certainty, that is the certainty of rehabilitation of criminals. So our volunteers will reach out, will identify the skill set, will identify training needs, and would provide the financial support, would provide the state guarantee, and will make sure that the people are rehabilitated and they are having legal means of livelihood rather than depending on crime. And so with these five certainties, we are visualizing that there will be crime-free Bharat. In beginning, it will be more effective when there's a financial incentive or scheming crimes are there. But slowly, it will be in position to go for the other type of the crime also, which are reactionary in nature, because people will be having a greater degree of the faith in the system. Now, how it will happen when the cases are not being registered? So, as you know that we have created a legal act, and we have submitted it to the BPRND, and it is being submitted to the MHA for consideration and enactment. And we have given the name National Authority for Scientific and Technical Assistance in Investigation and Detection of Crime Act 2020, and it is guaranteeing right to privacy. It is guaranteeing the very the delicate balance of the power between the state and central government. It is making conduct of even a people sitting in the authority accountable. And if they use any information which accidentally come to their notice for any ulterior purpose, it itself will be an offence, and it will be a cognizable offence with the minimum 7 years of punishment, and it will be non-valuable. So authority which is there to help out, if they really breaches their own conduct, then they will be behind the wall. And similarly, anybody is trying to get into the data set, attempting to it will be a heinous offence. And whether hacker or otherwise, whosoever will try to intrude into, though doing that will not be possible, because there will be very robust engine. They are already identifying the person, they are already identifying everything, and they are identifying and capturing evidences for the cyber activity. So the moment somebody will be crossing a Lakshman Rekha, we would be in position to prosecute. But this law provides that that such attempt will be very serious offense, and with the cognizable, non-valuable, with a minimum 7 years of punishment. Now, Professor Bajpayee is the fittest person to really give his impression about the crime-free Bharat, and how his committee would be helping us out, so that let there be a legal enabling, so that nobody should be in position to draw technical lacunas here and there, and such a powerful concept should be available for the benefit of the public. So I request Professor G.S. Bajpayee to please deliver his address on this, to really enlighten us on that, and then probably we will be having a dialogue. So he can ask question to me, and I will be asking question to him. Thank you.
Very good evening, and thank you, Shri Gupta ji, for this opportunity. First of all, I am very thrilled to note this idea you have spoken me the other day, and when you gave this the details of this project, I find it very interesting for several reasons. However, today I am not that well equipped to give my comments to all the aspects of this entire work, because this is very specific, especially when you are proposing it in a very formal way, including the proposed bill that you have created. But what I understand, and I'll confine my views around certain very vital issues which may have some bearing on what you are trying to do legally and otherwise also. So first of all, for me, crime-free India looks a very ambitious project, and this is a direction that the Indian police and the law enforcement agencies must embark upon, because for a very long time we have not been very, very preventive as a society and as a police. Now, if you look at the original idea of policing, when Robert Peel has conceived the whole idea of policing, so the principles that he has enumerated, so one of the principles was to enlist the community support in the prevention of crime, was something very important. But what we thought that this is something very ritual, and we never realized that there can be some very systematic ways and means to do this particular exercise. I have certain things and some preliminary remarks to make. See, I am a criminologist and I look at crime as a reality. Crime is such a stark reality of the society that Durkheim says crime is integral to the fundamental social conditions. Now, he is saying it is integral to the fundamental socio-economic condition or socio-structural condition in the society. So he said crime is inevitable because what is happening in the society, crime is a, you know, crime is linked to all those things. Therefore, we realize over a period of time, because this has been my area of interest. So what I realize that every society has a optimal crime rate, given the problems that we have. And I'm sure the expression crime-free has been made in that context. It's not the zero crime. What we are trying to achieve through crime-free project, that we should not have an abnormal crime rate picture in our country. We should not be unusual and uncommon. So first, let us understand and realize that what is the optimal crime rate of a particular society, how it is calculated. Because crime, we think is... Because I said the other day in a writing, which create a lot of ripples in the water, I said crime is quite independent of law and policing. So this I said in the context of Hathras, when police was being targeted and every, so whatever you do, but I can tell you with a lot of conviction that police do not have much control over the conditions and causes that are responsible for crime. Therefore, their direct preventive capacity is never enough, because crime is a multifaceted, multidimensional phenomenon. So sources of crime lie elsewhere. If you want to intervene the sources of crime, you have to go beyond the narrow confines of law enforcement and legal boundaries. That is a fundamental truth. And we, of course, since police becomes the first agency to react and to respond to crime, so we tend to gather an impression that police has all the possibilities and all the preparedness to deal with crime. That is all right. But I'm saying it is too ambitious and too unrealistic to expect that the police can control everything what is happening in the society in terms of crime. Because criminologists over a period of time, they have been pointing out that what kind of country you are, what is your socio-political makeup, all these things are contingent upon what is happening in the society. Now, crime-free India is something I think a very modest target could be to minimize the crime rate where they are abnormally high. Unfortunately, the crisis that I'm coming to my first observation is people do not, do not take it in a very surprising manner, but I always feel very awkward when I say that first of all, we don't know what is the actual extent of crime in India. We don't know what is the patterning of crime in India. NCRB has done tremendous job in last 10 years, of course. Before 10 years, they were definitely compiling, but now they have gone. But when I look at the crime statistics, which is compiled by National Crime Record Bureau, they say that you have around 650 crimes per 100,000 people. What does it mean? And this 6,500 people include all kinds of people in the population who are not relevant for crime, like aged people, like children. So we don't know what is the effective rate of crime in this country. So first of all, we are just not knowing what is actually crime that we are having in our country. That is number one. So, and because the Scandinavian countries, which are considered to be almost crime-free, their crime rate is over 5,000 per 100,000 people. America and Canada, which have 20,000 crime rate. I'm saying that the crisis of data is the first, because we do not have a data-driven decision making in our country. We respond to a situation which we don't know how does it exist, in what shape and what form it does it exist. So our crime prevention exercise is basically, groping in the dark. Groping in the dark, I say. So in terms of preventive, we have created a regime which is not clear as to what they are trying to do. Like, for instance, if you look at, to begin with, the CRPC. CRPC has a chapter number 11. And this chapter is dedicated to preventive action of the police. And this is the smallest chapter in the CRPC. Why? 5 sections. So if you look at 149 to 153, only 4 sections. Why? This is the importance that we have, assigned to the institution of police. When I was as a committee, when we were looking at these chapters, which are chapter number 8, chapter number 9, chapter number 10, chapter number 11, so peacekeeping sections, law and order related section, all these sections are lesser invoked, sections. So how come chapter 11 is so limited? Because you couldn't think of what police can do in terms of, we are actually looking at this chapter, that what else can be added where you can really assign some direct role to the police in terms of prevention. And the legal regime, as I said, is already very limited as far as, because law we have created never in a manner or never in a fashion which would finally be addressing to the preventive requirements in the law. So you have prefixed the term prevention in dozens of acts which have a prefix prevention. Prevention of Corruption Act, Prevention of Domestic Violence, Prevention of this, that, all. So you just look at, so on one occasion I tried to examine what is preventive about these acts. So they said prevention means the police will act, the cases will come, they will investigate, they will prosecute, there will be punishment. I said, where is the conscious and active prevention? Of course, this process does result into the prevention of, because objective of punishment has always been deterrence, expiation, reformation, kind of thing. But how does a particular preventive act is functioning? How does it function? Because there is no preventive design available which should be organized. Like, for instance, how should it be? Because to me, I think that would be very specific to your project, and you are rightly going on 5 levels of certainty. I have always felt that prevention has to be specific. Prevention cannot be general. What is general? That is called, a kind of, I would say, very indirect form of prevention. So suppose a police patrolling is taking place in the city, definitely deters the antisocial elements and they refrain from indulging into, but we don't know actually how many incidents we have prevented. And therefore, as I have mentioned earlier, that in the UK, when I was pursuing my work, I realized that the UK government has come out with a very massive, ambitious plan of crime reduction. And if you see, the first principle that they have applied in their crime reduction plan, it was emerging from a very theoretical idea. And how the theory has been translated into practice is something to watch for in a country like India. So a study was conducted by Ron Clark. Ron Clark was initially in England. He was a great criminologist. Later, he shifted to US. But he is considered to be the main person, main key proponent of this entire idea of crime reduction. He suggested opportunity makes crime. He said it is the abundance of opportunities which are very, very important, and they result into, in 40% of crime in any society is directly attributable to the easy availability of the opportunities. This was the research. It is available, you can see. And he said another thing. He said these 40% crimes are preventable, reducible. People ask, what about others? He said, other forms of crime are committed by the offenders who are very motivated. You cannot check the motivation of the offender. So you cannot demotivate the offender. Offender is out. He is likely to commit crime. But opportunities which are perceived to be the main reason for crime in several places, all kinds of crime, and those opportunities can be plucked. Those opportunities can be intervened. Those opportunities can be mapped. And he has carried out an experiment which became known in the entire US, and it is nowadays called problem-oriented policing. And POP, he is the man behind POP experiment. And he said, crime reduction has to be specific. So suppose in a particular area, there is a thousand cases of motor vehicle theft every month. It means next month again they are going to take place on average. So average crime rate means whatever you do, that crime level will be there. Now, if you have any paraphernalia, mechanism, intellect, measures, whatever, can you deploy some of those things to show us that we have been able to cut this average rate, say by 10%, 20%, 30%? And if you are able to do that, it is a certainty that you are reducing crime in a certain manner. So suppose 1,000 cases of vehicle theft has been reduced to 700, means you have reduced 300 cases by your active deployment of certain tactical, managerial, and security-centric measures. So we are not deploying our police and our capacities in general. We are deploying our capacities to a very specific requirement. So when you say crime-free or when you say crime prevention, my first question remains, what kind of crime you are asking to prevent? All crimes are, crime is not a single, actually for me it is always problematic. I never, treat crime as, all crimes as something similar. All crimes are on different pedestal, and all crimes have their own process of genesis, own process of growth, own process of development, and therefore their preventive techniques will always be different. Like today, a very big global conference on money laundering ended. It was reported in newspaper. Now, money laundering prevention would be very different. Organized crime, white collar crime, tax evasion. These prevention of these crime is very different from prevention like property offenses, sexual offenses. So I think preventive policies should be geared to the type of offenses that we are intending to prevent. You cannot have a general preventive scheme fit for all kind of formula. Because certainty of prevention will succeed only when we are identifying crime. So like, for instance, there was a lot of you cry against sexual assault cases these days in Delhi. And I am invited every week for some meeting or the other relating to sex. I said sexual offenses is one category where in terms of prevention, you could not do anything. So if a student raised hand and he asked a very interesting question to me, and that stuck, and then we did some. He asked, sir, do you think Nirbhaya was preventable? Nirbhaya case was preventable. Now, this is a very good question. So because we don't know. So then when we looked at, I think, we have forgotten one thing. Suppose there is a doctor. Now, doctor is he's also a professional like police, like him. So when doctor confronts some problem in terms of, giving any treatment to any particular. So doctor, if doctor is in need of some knowledge or some guidance, he has medical science books available and he would look at the medical research, medical journals. Now in crime science, for police, we have not created any knowledge base where the police should go. Because you have not created your knowledge territory very clearly. Because we have a police training, we don't have police education. We have medical education, we don't have a police education. So what I'm trying to say, answers of several such thing is there. So I was mentioning you, Hathras incident happened. Entire discussion was centered around the post-incident process. Our entire engagement is post-incidental. I asked a question, was there anything that the police has done by way of pre-incident initiatives, anything? When I probed a little deeper, I found these two families were known to each other for quite some time. They had the instances of clash and disagreement leading to some kind of dispute and some kind of issue which was taken to the police station at a very initial stage. There were some reputational issues, some dignity issues. Police at the initial instance, when the matter was taken to them, they said, "This mein kya hai? There is nothing in it. There is nothing registrable. It's not a crime. Nothing has happened. You better go and solve it." What I am saying, a large number of non-cognizable crimes which are taken to the police and not really given any attention to by the police and not even looked into, because non-cognizable, you need not to diminish. But I think there is need to create some kind of intervention into it. Because these non-cognizable are sometimes, you know, seen into serious cases of cognizable offenses. So as a police officer, as a scientist, as a criminologist, we are given to this understanding that the cognizable and non-cognizable crimes are two different categories. 70% crimes, non-cognizable and cognizable, are interlinked at some stages. We never look at from these lenses. We have no system of intervening these. If you want to prevent crime, if you want to really want a crime-free society, we need to look at these disputes which have a potential to become serious cases. And that's why you will find these crimes then are not intervened and they become serious issues. No, nature of crime, as I have already said, would require a different strategy. In law, our traditional laws, especially IPC, CRPC, Evidence Act, they have been modeled after a very, basic regime of, legal system. But most, very often, I find a lot of local and special laws are very important, which are very new. There we find a lot of, scope of, crime prevention. So I think some obligations of the enforcement agency can be created by way of amending the laws, etc. And another problem which I note, because I have worked in DPR&D in my initial years, and when in Delhi, the community policing project was launched, and there was a lot of interest shown by the people and the police those times. And it looked that as if it will become a real experiment in intervening crime. But community policing, I have done an evaluation of community policing in several states. And I found gradually this is getting, faded. It is getting vanished. Reason is, we have a tendency not to institutionalize the best practices that have come out of the experience of some very successful police officers. Now, what is happening that we do not attach much importance to these things which are called the soft policing? No credit is given. We think policing means ambush, we think policing means encounter, we think policing means arrest. The report which Tata Trust report on the state of justice 2019 and the state of policing 2018 by CHRI. Both the reports are very important to read. And in both the reports, very interesting findings have been made. They are saying that the capacity of the policing or the capacity of the police need to understand. You have, you know, expanded the reach of criminal law to, you know, infinite dimension. Daily you'll find nobody knows how many laws you have. And without having any regard to a realistic assessment, you keep introducing law, next law, this law, that law. And you are not bothering about the capacity of the police. When I say capacity, I'm not saying infrastructural capacity. I'm saying the preparedness of the police to do. So it doesn't matter if you bring a law, it will not be successful. Another dimension, that we don't know how the laws are working because we don't have any law impact assessment system in our country. We don't know how a law is working. We get to know all these things from newspaper, that a law is functioning or not. I'm saying you are ready to bring a love jihad law. You are ready to bring criminalize triple talaq. Who will do all these things? Police, as the data suggests, that police do not have more than 20 or 30% of their time to the investigation work. This is the problem. So if you are bringing, you are doing over-criminalization. This is over-criminalization, basically. The United States has suffered from this syndrome. And they are bringing back to the basics of policing again. They are saying that too many laws, too many arrests. And interestingly, we have linked the arrest by police as a measure of success. So if police is making arrests, they are successful. No, what is happening? And that's why the BPRND way back 2-3 years ago, they have, because I do a lot of training for police and a lot of things, I find there is a lot of confusion. So if there is a chapter on a law of arrest, if there is a chapter on investigation, interestingly, unlike other laws, there is no rules. CRPC doesn't have any rules. Evidence law doesn't have any rule. No, how the police will, you know, respond to these issues. Like, for instance, we are talking about fair investigation. What is fair investigation? You don't have any rule. Fair investigation is a judicial construction. So judiciary is saying that fair policing, fair investigation. They are saying arrest. Now, arrest law has become a most problematic thing. Now, BPRND has come out with a standard operating procedure. I think we need to simplify the laws so that, you know, their better application, their better use, their better implementation is, you know, becomes possible legally. I think, so what we are doing, we are bringing out certain rules also alongside the, so like on investigation, we are particularly looking at a set of rules. So suppose FIR registration. FIR registration is just limited in 4-5 section, that 154. Yeah. It doesn't really specify in a very elaborate way that what police is supposed to do in a variety of situation. In the absence of any direction, so many things operate, and this confusion is always taken advantage of. Yes. You are muted, actually.
I'm having some question to really ask in between, because our problem lies that we live with the problem. We are happy with the problem. where is the attempt to find out solution, number one. Number two, here we have, I think all of us, including police and everybody, we have conspired to keep public in dark. If you recall, I asked a question from you, do you know that you are a police officer? So basically, each citizen of India is a policeman. And when I am saying, I am not making any emotional statement, I am making a absolutely legal statement. Under Section 39, forget about the crime, even if you are having information of intention to commit crime, that need to be legally reported to police, failing which you could be prosecuted, and the burden of proving innocence lies on you. That kind of powerful law is there, number one. Now, number two, there's a specific section which says arrest by a private person. And the same section says that on production, police will be re-arresting such person. I never come across even a single case where the police has re-arrested somebody. And it has, in that case, the name of the memo should be re-arrest memo. Okay? It cannot be arrest memo. It has to be re-arrest memo. It means public has already arrested that culprit and now police is re-arresting it. Now, when I am having the duty to report a case, I am having the duty to arrest a person if a cognizable crime is committing in front of my eyes. This is my, and failing which I will be prosecuted also,
yes,
theoretically. Then how it is that somebody will say, it is my satisfaction whether to register it or not, when there's already provision available that if somebody reports wrongly, the person can be prosecuted under law. So when that provision is existing, not registering the case and by then investigating, inquiring, conducting the studies and reviews and research, to my mind, it is basically we are trying to beat about the bush. We do not want to hit the problem from the street. So let's not talk of the number, because as you rightly said that you are not very sure what is the real crime happening, how much crime is not registered, or because we are not very sure what kind of the treatment will be meted out. So we are not too eager to report it also. So the problem is not that police is not registering. Problem is that till it is not very mandatory and I am not having something on around my neck, I may be unwilling to report because I know that when I will go to the thana, I am not welcome over there. I will be maltreated and I may be pushed from the thana on one pretext or other, unless I go there with some kind of reference, with some kind of the pressure, then only probably I will get a hearing. Now, in that kind of the scenario, any kind of the study, any kind of the research, any kind of the going into the data, those data are not reliable. So why we are not talking of the action? Why we are not talking of the straightaway action? We are just talking simple thing. We are not talking of the changing of law. We are just talking, it is the sovereign responsibility of the government and of the police to register the crime and provide the safety and security under jo hai very important responsibility of entry 2. And if you must have read one of the things which I have written very recently, in which I have said one website was launched on 30th of August 2019. It was for the cyber crime. In last 1 year, more than 2 lakh crime they have been reported through that website. And less than 2.5% of an FIR have been registered. It means we are just not, when it is coming through a very bona fide channel, when all the documents are being uploaded, even then the person is not getting the relief in terms of getting his crime registered. Now, if we are saying it is the responsibility of the state government, then should be treated as a failure of constitutional machinery, and such government should be liquidated for not providing the rule of law, for not providing the response mechanism as conceived by the constitution. Constitution has given a proper framework, law has given a proper framework. Authorities are taking too much of liberty in not really taking cognizance, not really responding, and when it is happening in less than 2.5% cases, and if we will discuss state-wise, probably there may be few states may be the zero response or zero recording. There is likely depend upon to look into the dynamics ke how that 2.5% is really distributed from between the state. So there may be few states where maybe the registration of crime may be zero.
Yes, yes.
Now how we jo hai can talk of or study and things like that when the raw data itself is absolutely rubbish. I feel just like swimming cannot be learned by jo hai describing ke do this way that way. Swimming cannot be learned when you jump into the water. Swimming, we are doing fairly bad. Let's not dramatize things. Let's not do this thing and that thing. We are talking very simple thing. कि साहब आप cognizance ले लीजिए, the certainty of cognizance होना चाहिए. वहीं पे हम कह रहे हैं कि यदि कोई झूठी report करेगा, तो हम उसको certainty से prosecute करेंगे. तो हम ये भी नहीं कह रहे हैं कि साहब जो है ना कोई झूठी report करके उसको वो करेगा. हम यहाँ भी ये कह रहे हैं कि 211 and 182 should be made cognizable. We are saying कि इसका punishment भी वही होना चाहिए जो कि झूठी report जिस crime की आप झूठी report कर रहे हैं. तो यदि आपने rarest of risk रेयर केस का जो है ना फ्रेम करके एक केस तैयार किया है तो थ्योरेटिकली फॉर रिपोर्टिंग और क्रिएटिंग सच काइंड ऑफ द फॉल्स रिपोर्ट सच फॉल्स कंपोनेंट कैन बी थ्योरेटिकली बी हैंग्ड ही शुड डिजर्व ए कैपिटल पनिशमेंट इन रेयरेस्ट ऑफ रेयर केस नाउ वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ दैट वे देन ओनली इट विल बी ए बैलेंस्ड एक्ट आई फील टू मच ऑफ द रिसर्च इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड बिकॉज बेसिक्स आर नॉट बींग डन Now yes. come to the second. We are saying detection will be based on a very powerful engine. It will be working on various probabilities which are beyond the capability of police. Those engine will dig out. On the basis of that engine, the requisition will flow. Further, digital and non-digital evidences would be captured. The system would be helping poor IOs, जिसकी कोई सुनने के लिए तैयार नहीं है जिसके जो है ना वो रिक्वेस्ट भी जो है ना ठीक ढंग से नहीं करता है कायदे से उसको कहना चाहिए कि इन एक्सरसाइज ऑफ पावर कॉन्फिडेंस सो एंड सो यू प्लीज जो है ना यू आर डायरेक्टेड टू गिव दिस इंफॉर्मेशन एट दिस प्लेस फेलिंग व्हिच यू विल बी प्रोसीक्यूटेड अंडर सेक्शन 188 ऑफ द आईपीसी उसको इस तरीके के नोटिस जारी करना चाहिए व्हेन आई वाज द डीजी रेलवे वी वर यूजिंग दिस लीगल लैंग्वेज ओनली आवर आईओज वेयर प्रोहिबिटेड टू यूज एनी अदर लैंग्वेज वी हैव सब्सक्राइब दिस वो एंड वी वर टू कीन that if they will not comply with my order, we will prosecute them under 188. And I was too keen to do that. But unfortunately, everyone complied with our direction because they knew that what kind of the DG is this and he is going to prosecute without failing. So that kind of the fear is required. At present, people are denying not to give the information. When there is some statutory protection is available, state governments are not giving the permission to prosecute such officer. I mean,
yes.
how it could happen that way? How hum lachari se kaise jinda reh sakte hain? Hum rule of law ki baat kyon nahi kar rahe hain? And it is not question of creating law. It is question of creating compliance body. It is question of creating executive body. And that's why we are saying ki we will de-burden and de-stress police. Whatever this police is doing, our engine will push parallel to get it through the public also. And by doing so, we are creating powerful evidence because it is very important. Just let me allow a half minute only. What I am saying, we have created a very weak police. So whatever the police is saying, the statement recorded by police under 161 can only be used for the contradiction, but not for the corroboration. So why to use police? Even when police is being used, in parallel, I would like to push because I am having 137 volunteers because each and every citizen will be part of us. And since I am creating 5 revenue streams, so no citizen would be in position to afford not to be part of this system because he will be missing out so much of the revenue. No one would be gonna afford to be not to be out of this. I will later explain that how that revenue is coming. So what I am saying, why not to get the evidences from the body which will be more admissible in court of law, which can be used more directly, even whether it is a confession, whether it is a non-confession, whether it is identification, everything could be done through the public. And this engine would be using public in a very, very big way. Even whatever the task is being given to the police, in parallel, it will be given to the local volunteers also, and probably a lot of information will be flowing from there, which will be admissible in court, and that will be used for the corroboration, not for the contradiction. And that information will be logged with the date, time, and location, so it will enjoy very high reliability. Now, the same is, let's help out our court. Why the 3 crore cases are pending before the court? So our engine is would be helping them out to issue the summons and warrant. Our engine would be in position to help them out to conduct the video-based trial system, which would be attempting to dissolve 3 crore pendency at its earliest. And we intend to create an action plan so that this pendency could be dissolved in a year, but not later than 2 years. Because that is the requirement. Justice delayed is justice denied. So Dr. Vajpayee, I would like to request you to really comment more on the engine which we are suggesting on the crime-free Bharat. Because if we will keep on discussing whatever is being said earlier or case or not, then it is not going to help out. So the things which we are suggesting, how you would like to really comment on that, number one. Number two, how your since you are in a making of the law also, and your committee is supposed to propose that likely amendment. So I would like to request you to take me on board, number one. Number two, I would like that some kind of the legal enabling should be done so that people should not be in position to find out. Though whatever the engine we are creating within the present legal framework, and from my point of view, the zero amendments are required. But we do not want to leave some lacunas. Just as I was discussing with you, somebody may say that 154.3 says it can be sent by the post. So, sir, electronically, how can it be done? How it can be routed through the CCTNS? Though it is. भाई उस समय पोस्ट ही साधन था, आप इलेक्ट्रॉनिकली भेज सकते हैं, तो क्या दिक्कत है? कोई दिक्कत नहीं है. सो इवन सम विशिएटेड माइंड शुड नॉट बी इन पोजीशन टू रेज सच काइंड ऑफ सुपरफ्लस ऑब्जेक्शंस. सो दैट इफ वी कैन रियली मेक दैट काइंड ऑफ द इनेबलिंग, वी आर हेल्पिंग पुलिस इन गेटिंग ऑलमोस्ट ऑल केसेस डिटेक्टेड. वी आर हेल्पिंग आउट द पुलिस टू हैव अबंडेंस ऑफ द एविडेंस. That, and I have given the analogy of the cricket match, that in cricket match now the umpire will not be making a mistake. So the similarly, the judges and magistrate, they will not be making mistakes, because there will be plenty of the infallible evidences which could be will be made available. Even we would be in position to help the court if the some false document is being submitted for as a evidence. Our backend engine will identify and will say it is a false evidence, and a petition will be moved before the court. Okay, this is the offense under this section, so kindly take cognizance. If I will take second. If the technology alone cannot do, so it will take the whole report to someone to sign it, and then it making use of the ICJS, it will be reaching out to the magistrate. Hey, take cognizance, Mr. Vajpayee.
Yes, so actually I'm little, short of time. Just 5 minutes I have. I'll just, briefly respond to what you said. Since I'm really not fully aware, I have not seen your whole project. Therefore, I can't comment the legal ground or basis. But one thing that I am clear and I am in agreement with you, that the basic compliance of the law, perhaps you are missing one important thing. Whenever a law is made, the compliance is inbuilt. Compliance may happen, may not happen, but it is expected to be complied. Now, why compliance is not happening? If you go into, you will find a number of factors. And the entire effort to nullify those factors is something very, very important. So for us, it looks that the police officers are anybody who is not complying with the law he's doing so without any reason. No. The point is, there are serious reasons behind it. Otherwise, if laws are there and compliance is happening, so Mr. Gupta, there is no challenge. The country would have been a heaven. The real challenge, as I have said, look at the World Justice Project. The most massive, most intensified work that they have done over the years to say that this basic idea, compliance of the law and rule of law. So rule of law is not an idea. Rule of law is a framework. Rule of law is a practical requirement. But rule of law compliance in this country, so if we do not have the index of the compliance of law, we don't have compliance of law by the officials who are manning the law, who have the ownership of the law. State has the ownership and monopoly of the law. But state agencies, for different reasons, are not into the complete compliance. So we are creating several venues. Like, for instance, I'm responding to your question. I was looking at Section 330 and 331 of IPC, which was introduced to prevent the custodial torture. If you look at the enforcement of these two provisions, it is absolutely dismal. So it's not that we have not brought up. So to counter some problem, we again bring some provision. But that provision again will not be. So we need to understand that why the compliance by the people who are responsible for it is not happening. If you probe this particular issue, you will come to several reasons. I don't want to get into those reasons. You are most familiar. I am saying we have to make it very difficult for the people to violate the law, are including police officers. At the moment, we have made it very easy. If you know that you can get away with the violation of law, in all possibility, you will try to do that. Human being is a very selfish person. Fundamentally, I'm telling you. You cannot. So people, when they try in a country like India, when people have a variety of issues, existential problem, all kinds of, they have so many temptations, basically. So by not registering, I always say, people are making hue and cry for pendency and for lower disposal of it. It is my firm conviction that if the state wants, the entire pendency can be wiped out in a matter of 5 years, less than 5 years. Why it is not happening? Have you ever thought? It is not happening because there are sections in your society who do not want it to happen. When a case gets into pendency, or when an FIR is not registered, certain interests
it means the desire or vested interest will decide what should happen and what should not happen.
So I am not into should. I am not into should. I am into what is happening. Now, what should happening is already clear. I am telling you, Mr. Gupta, ki expectations are clearly written in our law. How the law should be enforced, how the law enforcement should happen, what is the expectation of the law, what is the rule of law, is there any ambiguity? Laws are wonderful. Problem is, as I'm saying, the enforcement part and the enforcement, that's what I'm saying. Developing any program in this country is a challenge. Challenge for not, because there are the people, I would say there are people, there are honest people, there are determined people, there are good people who would try to do this. But
I am saying, I am not interested in goodness of anybody. I am saying, say, if you take fire on your hand, does it ask that, ki jo hai na, should I burn you? If you take ice on your hand, it will cool you, it will not ask you. So what I am saying, whosoever is not doing it, let there be a inbuilt engine to identify it. Why anybody should write ACR of any police officer or for that matter for any bureaucrat?
These are very complex questions.
Just a minute. Let that work be captured. It should be on a performance index should be created, because the technology is looking not only to your action and compliance, it is looking even to the micro element of your compliance.
Correct.
It is also looking into the quality of your compliance.
Yes.
So it can go very objectively and it can go into the micro details to create a performance index. Now, imagine a situation, if you have not registered 1,000 cases, and if the DE will be issued with certainty, and if the responsibility of the SP is fixed, or DIG and IG and DG is fixed with certainty, a charge sheet will be served on them, do you feel that this crime will prevail? So you are saying
I agree. So, which means you need to create those mechanisms which are technology driven, so which are AI driven.
These mechanisms are being created in Crime Free Bharat. In 5Certainty, the backend engine is already doing that.
You mentioned. So, I have yet to look at that. What is, you can share probably in next private discussion. I would be a lot more specific to those components to be able to really pinpoint the exact, you know, core of that particular problem. And hence, then probably we can discuss a little more. But it was wonderful today to really talk to you and you know, share. And I got a lot of ideas from your. But I'm happy that your determination and your clarity on your project is absolutely brilliant. And I'm quite sure that this will go a very long way. I'm telling you, these efforts and these kinds of initiative, despite what is happening, there is a scene which is gloomy, but always one candle is enough to dispel the darkness at times. So you are that candle, and we are winning a lot of hopes. And I, after a lot many years, I am coming across with someone who has a lot of clarity about those ideas. Challenges are always there. Challenges should not deter us. But I like that you have a very clear vision of your project and how you are going to tackle it, those barriers. That is also probably inbuilt in your program. That is something very interesting to know. So please share those papers to me at the earliest so that I can really imbibe the entire understanding of your work, and probably we can sit down next time to have a lot more focused discussion on all the aspects.
So, really, thank you very much for the highly encouraging words. The moment the session is over, I promise that I will be sharing you with the concept note that is already recognized as a national police mission. I will be sharing that draft act that is the National Authority for Scientific and Technical Assistance and Investigation and Detection of Crime. I will share that I have given a, because it was asked by the BPR&D, that I should suggest the implementation strategy. So I have submitted implementation strategies also.
Wonderful. And, I would be really interested to know.
Yeah. And 54 universities and a lot many freelance experts, they are working with me. Every day I am making few teams to create some module. So we are creating technical solution, we are creating legislative solution, and we are creating awareness solution also.
Wonderful.
We say, it should be the our matter of right. As you rightly said, some interest group, some people, influential people, they do not want this to happen. That's why it is not happening.
I am saying
such influential people should be sacked through by the basically the support which should be created in favor of this crime-free Bharat, because this crime-free Bharat is not only giving you the 5Certainty, it is giving you the 5 revenues. And if we press one button, all whole population, then it will be creating 1,30,000 crore rupees for the government, and the same amount will be created for the public as well. When that kind of the enormous volume of the money is being created, the per capita income is going to move at least 3 times. That kind of powerful system is there. So when we are creating technical system, when we are creating legislative system, when we are creating support system, it will be really too bad if we are not implementing this kind of the powerful system. I am feeling quite powerful and quite encouraged by your kind words. And
no, it's pleasure. It's
Very shortly, we will be having a second session also with you.
Sure.
When you can really go through the concept note and other details. And
yes,
I am sure that then that will be your turn to say how it should be made little more powerful. So you should be in position to identify the gaps where I should pay little more attention. And doing that is very easy for me, because the moment I get some problem, I constitute a committee and our team start working on it. And we are creating solution within 2 months. That is on that speed we are working. And yes. I'm very sure BPR&D is very supportive, MHA is very supportive. So we are, in case of the railway crime, they have already created one study come implementation committee. I'm very sure very soon they will be creating another implementation committee for the crime-free Bharat also. Because what I feel, a single individual doing that much is beyond the capacity of one person. I feel that patronage blessing from the Honorable Prime Minister, from Honorable Home Minister must come for this grand vision that is the need of the hour for our country. And if we can make our country crime-free, there's no reason why it should not be done. And we are having powerful engine to even prevent the crime. And this powerful engine is not banking on police. And it is not having only one responder. That is not the police. It is having n number of the responder. And large number of the responder will be coming from public. So it will be making a... And we are already burdening. We are already saying that we will unburden and de-stress police. So I think police is going to benefit it in a very big way. And I am of the opinion when the same police with this powerful engine would be registering all offenses, would be detecting all offenses, would be getting conviction in all cases, that too in record time, then such police will be worshipped in time to come. Whenever any policeman will be moving on the street, I am very sure a time will come when the public will rise in the honor of such person.
Yes,
that,
I'm sure.
And I sincerely pray that it should happen, because unless the police is respected that way, things are not going to change. Because ultimately, whatever we will be doing, our visible hand would be the police only. So police Johanna would be doing the finally clinching act. Backend engine jitna bhi kuch karega, clinching act to Johanna police hi karegi, right?
Yes, 100%. So yes, yes.
With this word, really? Johanna, I sincerely thank you, Dr. Vajpayee, and very soon we will be having second session. I will be sharing all kind of the document with you, and I will be once again requesting that if possible, I will be too happy to be the on board on committee on the law reform.
Sure.
And let's join hand to make it happen.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you, one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Regards.